So let's then go to actual competition policy, so policy question, particular of market definition, which is basically the starting point of any competition assessment by a competition authority. So you remember that there are many of those competition cases, or at least applications of competition law, they rely on the fact that some company is dominant. So the exception is, of course, cartel. So a cartel is also prohibited if companies are only a very small market share. But you know, typically, in these, for instance, in these abuse of dominance cases, and also in these vertical agreement cases, they will only hold water if any of these companies has significant market power, or in other words, is dominant. So we have to identify, right? Is a firm dominant or not? Does it have a lot of market power? Well, that's easy, we would say, as economists. We just basically look at, you know, how many firms are there in the market. So if there's just two or three or four firms, yeah, that's a pretty, these will have a pretty dominant position, typically a lot of market power. And if there's many firms, no, probably not. But the real world is, of course, not our stylized model. The real world has many, many different products that, you know, are, some are closely related and some are slightly less closely related to the products that you are looking at. And so it just depends. So how many firms are there? Well, it depends how wide you will want to draw your market. So suppose is the market for bananas in Groningen, is that if that only would have one supplier, would that be worrisome? Well, it depends a bit, right? So if the question is, will people, if bananas are sort of made more expensive in Groningen, what will they do? Will they indeed just reduce the demand and pay the higher price, which would be a sign of market power? Or will they instead perhaps buy apples or oranges? So perhaps does that mean that the market for bananas is not a relevant market in itself? It might be need to be defined a bit wider as the total market for fruit. Or do we actually have to look at the complete market for edibles? Anything you can buy basically in the supermarket, should that all be included in the single market? In which case, a banana producer who is going to be the single producer seller of bananas in Groningen would not have that much market power. And you might imagine that actually, yeah, this is going to make a lot of difference, and the banana seller might argue, well, no, I have no market power whatsoever because people will just buy something else if I raise my price, whereas a competition authority who wants to take action might think otherwise and make this, want to define this market a bit more narrow. So the first step, and the contentious step in that, is indeed the step of market definition, and that's basically what Mata talks about in the book in chapter 3. So market definition basically is consists of two aspects. So one is what's a relevant product market, so that was what I was just trying to explain using the banana example. So is it just bananas, or are there also other products that are competing with bananas? But also, what's a relevant geographic market? So if prices for bananas go up in Groningen, does that mean we are going to pay those, or are we just going to import bananas from Germany or from a different city nearby Groningen? Okay, so that's a geographic question. So we have to look both at the product dimension and at the geographic dimension. So market definition basically is this. So a market is a set of products like bananas or fruit and geographical areas like Groningen and perhaps wider areas surrounding Groningen that exercise a competitive constraint on each other. So where behavior by one supplier might constrain what the second supplier might be able to do. So that involves answering these questions. Are there any substitutes for the product? So is, you know, are other types of fruit, are there any substitutes for bananas? And if so, well, these other types of fruits will actually exercise some competitive constraint on what the banana supplier can actually do with its prices. And similarly, geographically, we know that indeed the maximum price that you can ask in a local monopoly will be, well, constrained at least by the price of something non-local. So if we can go to Germany and import some bananas, which might be very cheap in Germany, well then that's going to constrain prices on banana centers in Groningen. Well, how strong is this effect? Well, it depends, of course, on particularly on the transportation costs. So what does it mean in practice? So in practice, we have to figure out, which other products and from which other geographic areas are going to affect significantly the competitive power or the monopoly power, rather, of producers in our hypothetical relevant market. And the typical way of doing this in competition cases, or one typical way, accepted way of doing this, is by using the so-called SNP test. So what does this SNP with two S's stand for? It stands for the small, first S, but significant non-transitory increase in prices. So what does that mean? So the SNP test just says, well, let's imagine we have figured out one hypothesis for how big this relevant market might be. Say it is just the markets for bananas in Groningen. Suppose indeed that the whole market for bananas in Groningen is controlled by one single hypothetical monopolist. We then ask, would this monopolist indeed be inclined to raise its prices by a small but significant amount, say typically 5 to 10% above the current price level? And would that be sustainable, so non-transitory, in making sort of profits over time? So an increase in prices, it's small but significant, and it remains in place. It's non-transitory. That's where this comes from. So if the answer to that is yes, if the all bananas were supplied in Groningen would be supplied by a single monopolist, and this monopolist could indeed make a profit by raising prices by, say, 5 to 10% in a sustainable way, then we would say, yeah, well, in that case, indeed, this market is a single relevant market. If the answer is no, because then there would certainly be competition from outside that particular market by the other fruit sellers, for instance, then the implication of that would be, well, then this small defined market is not the relevant market, and we have to cast our net a little bit wider, right? To consider a little bit wider market. And then for that slightly wider market, say, what kind of fruit, we have to repeat the same test. So what happens if all fruit were controlled by a single monopolist? Would that monopolist then be able to raise its prices by the small amount and make a profit? So we go on expanding this market step by step until the answer is yes. This hypothetical monopolist controlling everything in that size of market that we have now arrived at, that would actually profit from raising its prices by this amount. And then we've identified our separate market. So there's a little bit of a comment that I made here. So we're looking at the question, would a hypothetical monopolist be able to raise its prices above the current price level and make a profit? Well, of course, if the current level of profit is already the monopoly profit, because currently we are actually already looking at a monopoly, well, then that might not be a meaningful question, because then certainly there might be a large monopoly with large market power going on here. But by definition, this monopolist is already maximizing its profits, so raising its prices even more is not going to be profitable. So we would reject this hypothesis on false grounds. So this is what has come to be known as the cellophane fallacy, which is also reported in the book, from an ancient case on cellophane, the market for cellophane, where this was actually the case. People were comparing indeed prices in a market where there was a single monopolist, and they found out, oh well, this single monopolist will never raise its prices. Well, no, of course not. It was already setting the monopoly price. So that's something that you want to be careful about in practice. So read about it further in the book. So how do you make this operational in practice? So the ideal way of doing this is figure out, what are all the potential other goods that exercise competitive constraints on this particular good that we're interested in. that model all these potential goods, say all fruits or all edibles in supermarkets or whatever you wish. Try to find out what are all the price elasticities, so both the own price elasticity and particularly also the cross price elasticity. So in other words, estimate a complete demand model for all of these goods, and then just compute from that complete demand model what would be the effect of raising prices for this single good that we are interested in, or for the small market that we're interested in, and seeing, well, what would they do to profits. That will be basically the first best method. And we're going to do this actually in an exercise, in a very stylized exercise with just two goods, to see whether these two goods are actually, depending on cross price elasticity, are going to exercise competitive restraints on each other. It will be one exercise in the tutorial. So that's the first best method. Basically, that's the ideal. Well, often we cannot do this because it will be very hard, in particular in limited time frames, to measure all these cross price elasticities in a econometrically satisfying way. So what people do in practice is sort of have more rules of thumbs test, basically, like, are prices correlated between different markets? So if you're looking at apples and bananas, do we see that when prices of bananas go up for some reason, because the cost of producing bananas has gone up, does it also mean the cost of apples, which have different way of production, of course, have also gone up? Well, then that might mean that these markets are somehow connected through the demand side. So then there might be a large cross elasticity between these two goods, and they might actually be part of the same relevant market. However, you have to be careful a little bit, because there might actually be this correlation among prices between these different goods might not just be arrived at through competitive behavioral responses to prices in the other market, but it might also be related to common costs. So if all these fruits are sort of have as a common cost, or the same transportation costs, just fuel prices have gone up, and that's why fruit has become more expensive, then we would mistakenly draw the conclusion that all these kinds of fruits would be in the same market. So a common cost driver would sort of also cause correlation, unrelated, basically, correlation in prices unrelated to cross price demand elasticities. On the other hand, we might also be wrong on the other side. So if there's no correlation, that does not automatically mean that there is no competitive interaction between these two kinds of markets. So a lack of correlation might also be, for instance, a reflection of differences in transportation costs. So prices might, even though they affect each other in a competitive way, still they might move in different ways if costs, for instance, transport costs for these different goods move in uncorrelated ways, and that would then confound basically our conclusions that we draw from just some correlation tests. So typically, these tests, for these SNP tests or these operationalization of those SNP tests in particular, tend to be, you know, sometimes pretty lengthy exercises, and also exercises that are much debated in actual cases, because as I already explained, there are really strong incentives for companies to claim that the relevant markets are actually pretty big, so that they actually have very small market shares, whereas a competition agency wanting to make their case might actually be inclined to draw their relevant markets in a very narrow way. So we'll, of course, have a little bit of a look at the market in particular in all those cases that you will present, so particularly the on all the cases, in particular the first one, which will be on Ryanair, which we'll see in 2 weeks. So to wrap up the discussion for today, so what we have looked at is, first of all, the legal background to competition policy, what's the motivation for competition policy, what's the relation to efficiency, and we have had a first peek at actually how does competition policy work in practice. So this first step in each procedure, defining, demarcating basically what's the relevant market that we are actually interested in. Mind you, by the way, usually this is not just one market. Many companies are active in many different products, so we'll also be active in many different relevant markets. So ideally for each of these products, you would have to define such a relevant market. So we'll have a tutorial as well this week, and so you'll see the videos on that as well. So try those exercises for yourself, obviously. They will be this for this week. Review exercise mainly on efficiency and surplus. So you want to be make sure that you are very comfortable in doing basically the standard Kuno and Bertrand type of computations, which should be known to you. And there's also going to be this exercise on market definition. So next week we'll go on, we'll be considering basically mergers, in particular horizontal mergers. So next week we'll look at a paper. So make sure you read that paper when you watch next week's video. It's a paper by Farrell and Shapiro from 1990. And also have a look at Maltas chapter 5, which we'll discuss next week and the week after, actually. The final point is, so there will be these cases, so they will be done in groups, as I mentioned. So you will be requested to sign up, actually, for those cases. So I have made it on Nestor, actually, an allocation procedure here, so a registration procedure to sign up for cases in small groups. So there will be five different cases that you can choose from, and make sure that you sort of sign up for one of these groups for a particular case or week that you might be interested in. So that's it for today. So thank you for watching this video, and we'll see each other next lecture.